Eastern Siberia, remote and unapproachable region of the Western Sayan Mountains, where the Abakan River begins its run to the Yenisei. Here, in the geographical center of Asia, at the foot of the mountain slope and just above the confluence of Abakan with noisy Yerinat, the old Bilibe monastery with its only inhabitant Agafia Lykova sheltered from the outside world. The recluse Agafia, who was born, grew up, and was brought up in complete isolation from society, attracts human attention all 40 years after the resumption of contacts with the mainland. She attracts, as moths are attracted to a glowing in the dusk light, as it attracts the lighthouse to a safe harbor. Gone in the previous state, which forced her family to flee under the protection of Dan Staiga, and Yurasha is going through strength tests one after the other. The whole world is talking and pounding mercilessly on the geopolitical twists and bumps. In short, everything has changed since then, as a society learned about the epopee of the old believer family Lykov. 30 years lived on this side of the world. And now, it would seem, what all the matter to a man who slowly works a sickle, removing the rip and dry from a small plot? And the thing is, it turns out, that it is on this tiny and lost plot that time moves in a different dimension than in the bustling urban blocks, and even a year here is different. It's 7528 from the creation of the world. Here, everything is different than in the daily routine of the information age somewhere in the nearest village. So who is she? An unhappy human abandoned by fate in the grind of wildlife, or an ascetic who shows us the path of moral perfection?
Личности, встреча с которой, я думаю, что и для вас, и для меня, очень важная. Она, можно сказать, как камертон настраивает именно христианский, евангельский лад. И она сама отвечает, что мы жили как христиане, как и отец ее, как она. Вот, и, конечно, не жалеет об этом. Это сознательная ее позиция. Для сегодняшнего мира, я думаю, что очень важно, наверное, промыслительно даже Господь вот таких людей выявляет, показывает. И вот вы говорите, сейчас какое-то особое время, которое необходимо для выверения позиций. Я думаю, что в России, в Руси никогда простого времени не было. Возьмем 20 век, век вот этого трагического раскола, если про старообрядчество говорить, и испытания, когда было смутное время, и время татаро-монгольское, и так далее, и так далее. Никогда не было простого. Всегда Господь как-то давал людям для ориентации, для подкрепления именно таких людей, которые могли, как крепость, действительно, как крепость духовная, быть примером. Для нас очень важна личность протопопа Аввакума. Она что, наследница по старообрядческой линии, так по духовной, или боярни Морозова. Да, вот эти люди, которые вот, были богатыри, не вы, как печальная досталась доля, но действительно это люди, промыслом Божиим укрепленные, они показали пример, как нужно спасать свою душу. Ведь важнее ничего нет для человека, как спасти свою душу, как уберечь ее от соблазна, от растления. Действительно, сейчас это очень актуально в наше время. Хотя, я говорю, еще во все времена были, потому что дьявол всегда действует, может, образуясь какими-то обстоятельствами, современностями, но все равно это очень актуально для человека сбережение своей души. Ну, а Господь говорит, и Агафия, и другие подвижники делают это. Пост и молитва. Я все сейчас больше думаю, а почему так тянутся к ней люди? Вот корреспонденты, вот молодежь, студенты, я знаю, что многие. Да. Это действительно необходимость вот такой вот зарядки. Сейчас такое модное слово, сочетание «мастер-класс». Вот мастер-класс духовной христианской жизни она дает.
Queen Abaid Guri is now training such master class. He arrived on the Yerinat River at the end of August and was going to stay here until December. But everything turned out differently. It's March already, and the monk is still in the Taiga's quoting. His stay in the holy monastery on the Yerinat is a great success in the study of the phenomenon of Agafya's way of living. The catch here is that everyone who has ever been to the Taiga's quota, including Vasily Peskov with his sensational reports about the Taiga deadlock, as well as who meets Agafya today, all write and talk about the external and material factors of the life of the recluse, as if they are the key to understanding what holds Agafya in the wilderness, when it's already possible to move to the habitat places. Everyone has been long and delightfully telling us about all sorts of stories about the methods, with the help of which Likovs cultivated Taiga garden, showing this unusual garden and other, without a doubt, exotic and interesting details. But all this moves us away from the main thing, and most importantly, it's Agafya herself, with her inner world. It is she who is the greatest value possessed by the Taiga deadlock, and not the material artifacts of the recluse's life. The essence of this value is terra incognita for the vast majority of those who have heard about Agafya Likova. It turns out that Queen Abide Guri is now the most competent and authoritative expert on the spiritual meaning of the Taiga deadlock in Russia. He's like two in one for us, because he's experienced in the subtleties of spiritual warfare and has spent many months with the recluse, and therefore his comments are filled with more information than the travel notes of Agafya's fleeting guests, although they are without a doubt have their own importance and interest. We asked Father Guri if it was true that she was one of those whom the god hears and responds to her requests.
Ну да, есть такое выражение в Святом Писании, удерживающий, который вот сдерживает вот это все как беззаконие.
Относится к таким людям с вашей точки зрения?
Да. Она относится к этому разряду человек, людей православных, которые молятся и которые Господь слышит. А чтобы человека, ой, чтобы Господь услышал человека, он должен как раз вот иметь любовь, понимаете? А имея любовь, естественно, он богоугодный человек, его молитву Господь в первую очередь слышит. Ну, это, конечно, является результатом человека, как правило, говорит от того, чем наполнено сердце. То есть человек, уста человека говорят от сердца, от его полноты, чем оно наполнено.
Агафья Карповна нам все время только говорит вот о святых вещах.
Больше вот, видите,
не интересует.
Ну, ее больше ничего не интересует. Ее, вот я как вначале сказал про любовь, что к Богу, она теперь боится разлучиться. Это у нее это второй разряд, вторая ступень любви. Первая ступень, когда мы боимся из-за наказания, из-за того, что мы окажемся в этом в аду. Господь пугает нас и не напрасно этим огнем гиеном, чтобы мы обратились, услышали, обратились к покаянию. А ну, она уже на второй ступени, а вторая ступень – это уже все. Человек наоборот уже, вот как и боится разбудить ребеночка, у нее любовь, так она вот это боится каким-то, в кавычках, шорохом, да, разбудить Господа.
А ступени, это из тех 30 ступеней?
Нет, это только касается любви. Угу. Только касается заповеди об любви.
Близко,
да.
Близко к вершине?
Да, это уже близко к вершине. Это, в общем-то, вершина нашей жизни, подготовки души к Царству Небесному. Это уже вершина. Выше уже нет. Уже выше нет.
Вот она на такую вершину поднялась.
Ну да.
И вот и можно понимать так, что в России, наверное, таких людей немного,
не,
да?
Я боюсь, что нету сейчас таких людей. Но если есть, ну, может быть, на руке пальцев хватит. Это особый разряд людей. В подтверждении вот и есть то, что она здесь до сих пор живет. Это подтверждение, понимаете, ага, что она здесь живет, вот этой любви. Иначе бы она ушла в мир. хоть какую-то там цивилизацию. Даже пусть даже деревня, да? Но это уже общество. Это уже общество, понимаете? Здесь она в чистоте, какой получилась, научилась, и в том и пребывает неизменно. И чтобы эту чистоту увидеть, надо пожить, надо иметь звено вот этой любви, хотя бы первой ступени.
It is in this center of pristine purity, named Taiga de Dlog by Vasily Peskov and the Menhir 35 years ago, the student expedition of Mira is sent for the seventh time. The new trip is the second one this year. The previous one took place at the turn of spring and winter. What attracts the guys, forcing again and again to leave the metropolis with its comfort and go to such place where you need to be content with little, where flies and mosquitoes are constantly bothering you, where anything can happen, and where you have to work hard and not feeling sorry for yourself? The answer is simple: goodwill, hence the world, volunteers, and compassion and sacrifice, which are the basis of volunteerism. And there is a truth in the terms, which is familiar to everyone from childhood. But how to turn these basic things into concrete deeds when your day is shadowed by minutes? In other words, how to fight the routine of everyday life on the way to good work? The Holy Fathers at the dawn of Christianity gave a hint to the solution of an important moral task. It is necessary, they said, to look for any opportunity to do good. As for example, the old man Lykov, Agafya Karpovna's father, tried to look for. When he saw people for the first time for 30 years, and it were geologists, he immediately asked, "How can we help you?" As if a hermit, mercilessly hurt by life for 30 years, only waited for a moment when he would be able to help the geologist. And when he saw them, he immediately rushed to offer his help. For many years of seclusion, wise old man Lykov not only didn't forget the patristic instruction, but also taught us an instructive lesson of good deeds through the years, which as follows from his lesson, there are no boundaries in time or in content. And this nutritional basis for moral improvement meant Father Guri when talking about the atmosphere in which our master and mistress was raised, in which she lives, and how lucky the volunteers of Mira were to plunge in it. Watching Agafya Karpovna receive gifts brought from the mainland, let us remember the words of the Cainabite Guri, the man talks about what fills his heart. They help to understand the childish pure and bright interest to the icon. Not everyone is able to enjoy so sincerely and without looking at other people's eyes. Especially considering the fact that the object of quiet and hidden joy of the recluse is not vegetables and fruits, batteries and other important things for scarce taiga life, but the icon, or a year later, the books Hexameron and Menaeon.
Помните, вы письмо они писали, вот она ездила, покупала вам книжки.
Довольна.
And although Agafya Karpovna is somewhat similar to those grandmothers who are remembered by students when they share their impressions of visiting the Taiga monastery at first sight, and dressed, they say simply, and talking with the guys about the most ordinary things, and makes household chores in the same way as many of her age. But the reverence with which she treats any sacred thing is what makes her unlike these grandmothers. So it turns out, as our recent contemporary, the monk Paisios, noted in his spiritual instructions that the inner man nourishes himself with God and lives because of God. And reverence, he stressed, is inner modesty and spiritual sensitivity. The reverent person clearly feels the presence of God, angels and saints. And he has the constant idea in his mind that his body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and lives a simple, pure and blessed life. He said so a quarter of a century ago, like it was said about the recluse from the Taiga deadlock.
Она действительно говорит, что мы всегда жили христианской жизнью, живой пример христианской жизни. И спрашивают, а вы не жалеете, что у вас детей нет? Она так отвечает, она всегда очень добра. А не для этого живем. Действительно, не для этого живем. Тогда мы животные, там как куры, лягушки какие-то, да, вот они тоже, размножение все. Вот, конечно, она живет более высокой жизнью, жизнью, конечно, для Бога. А это и жизнь для людей. Конечно, вот я думаю, что даже не сознавая это, она же какие-то философии, что она кого-то там. Просто вот любовь к Богу и вот эта ее любовь, которая обращается уже к людям, вот это вот самое основное, что она вот это выработала в своей жизни, чем старше, тем больше это убеждается, в какой-то мере, по себе тоже. И вот это вот желание оставить что-то доброе, подарить людям вот хотя бы улыбку, хотя бы доброе слово, хотя бы напутствие для молодежи, для нее очень важно, какие-то подарки, хотя бы небольшие. Вот это очень важно, что она живет не для себя, а для других. А это как раз основное, как Господь об этом тоже говорит, что не живите для себя, а как можно больше вот этих сокровищ духовных раздавайте. Тогда вот эти сокровища войдут, как это говорит Шалы, как можно сказать. А вот это сокровище любви друг к другу, и к ближнему, к Богу, вот это сокровище, которые очень нужны нам. Я думаю, что промыслительно вот сейчас Господь таких людей, наверное, есть еще люди такие где-то. Просто мы как старобрядцы знаем Агафию, но я думаю, что есть такие люди просто среди нас, мы иногда просто не видим, они, как правило, скромные.
Don't live for yourself, the Lord just was saying. This idea is clear and indisputable. When a man is close to you, and you have the opportunity to selflessly do for him something useful. But how to be in the realities of the Taigada log, when other people appear rarely, though regularly, as volunteers of Mira? It may seem that Agafia Karpovna is deprived of the joy of being useful to someone else and has to wait for the arrival of guests for a long time to do something for them that fills her heart with grace. But it's not like that. Now she goes where the upper garden is located. Climb the mountain slope steepness of 45 degrees is not an easy thing at all, and even more at her age. In the upper garden she grows potatoes, and there are several beds. And on the back of the upper hut, in the thickest of forest bushes, a small pillow is hidden, the existence of which we became aware right now and quite by accident. It turns out that for two seasons the recluse has been growing potatoes here for a Russian couple that lives in Bolivia. Our overseas compatriots have engaged in conversation with the recluse when they deeply felt the severity of foreign land. From their letters coming to the Taiga deadlock was a rare occasion, Agafia Karpovna realized that these people are almost her countrymen. They are from the Chelyabinsk region, where Alikov's ancestors once lived, and that in Bolivia they have nowhere to lay their heads. These words, "nowhere to lay my head," absolutely blew her mind. So Christ answered to the apprentice who intended to follow him. And we know very well that the Lord reigns in the heart of the recluse, and therefore her response is understandable. Caught by a desire to host the fellow countrymen, she immediately started preparing food to them. It may seem to be just a fad, but Agafia Karpovna, who always uses evangelical language, would say no way. That is not just a fad, but what? Paisios of Mount Athos gives us the answer again. A man has just two pleasures, he said. The first is when he takes, and the other when he gives. Only by sacrificing a person is related to Christ, because Christ is the sacrifice. So by this unpretentious but expressive and very clear way, Agafia Karpovna has been preaching evangelical values during all her life in Taiga. The working stage of the exhibition begins. It was decided at a short meeting that some of the guys would mow the grass for hay for goats and others would chop firewood. There are 7 goats on the farm. Like, at the first glance, too much for one recluse, but Agafia Karpovna doesn't accept any other food, just her own. There are only flour and a little grain, which are imported. So without goat milk she wouldn't be able to live, as dry cottage cheese wouldn't be there. The whole protein intake of the winter period for the recluse is consisted of cottage cheese and fish. Meat food is almost absent in her diet. You can mow the grass in the Taiga deadlock only in two places, on the mountainside where there are several glades once used as a garden, and on the forest glades of the riverbank. But if on the hillside the grass dries itself, even in the short sunny period, you will need a special perch, meaning a special gable of the hut, to dry grass on the shore. Agafia Karpovna herself didn't seem to be going to mow the grass on the shore, therefore she didn't restore the gable damaged by the winds. But with the arrival of the student group, it became clear that she wouldn't manage without it. And since the workforce was multiplied and it was possible to harvest a lot of grass, the guys built 2 gables. Mowing the grass seems to be a simple matter, but our students have never had to deal with it. It becomes clear that such work, monotonous, boring, and unusual, requires certain volitional efforts to perform it for hours in an uncomfortable position. And here comes the spiritual factor. Getting into a difficult situation, a person passes a moral exam, because good is good only if a person sacrifices something of his own peace, habits, and in this case also the state of mind, which had to be reconfigured to new realities. Илья has been coming to Тайга-Дедлог as a volunteer for several years. Sharing his impressions of the previous trip, he said that he did a lot of things for the first time. Here in the Тайга Squadron, he in particular is chopping wood with an axe for the first time. And so, for the first time, through the example of a sheltered life, he saw how much the link of attention between people means. And with the approach of summer, he says, he is already drawn here by some unknown magnet. And here he is again, chopping wood. Firewood in the Тайга Дедлог is an even more important task. The walls are thin in all the hut here, the windows are made of just one piece of glass, the floor touches the ground, the door opens right into the street. And it's very difficult to keep warm in such conditions, especially in the bitter Siberian frosts. And she needs a lot of firewood. In addition, it's better the wood pile to be located as close as possible to the home. So the guys did. Several new wood piles were arranged on the edge of the clearing, where the grass was mowed. This firewood, however, still needs to be dried to become suitable for heating huts only in a year. But the wood harvested on the shore shallows is ready for use. It was made of dried post-flood stuff. Here, just dried chocks, unlike those that are obtained from freshly cut trees, are not easy to be split, no matter how hard you try.
Тут дышится легко. Ну, то есть, понятное дело, что в лесу вообще дышится легко, но здесь как-то по-особенному. Тут даже с учетом того, что ты целый день работаешь, все равно ты не так сильно устаешь, как в других местах. То есть тут как-то хоть и горы, и высота, и вроде как условия не, ну, неприемлемые, да, для нормальной жизни, но все-таки тут дается почему-то все более легко, особенно тяжелый труд.
Failed to do one very important thing – to install a fishing fence on the river, which is also called a fish weir. Fish weirs allow the recluse to catch the necessary amount of grayling. She dries this fish in a nearby booth, then jerks it and smokes it. Being engaged in this business in September and October in a booth, she lives and prays here. We were not able to install the dam due to high water in the Yerinat River, caused by the rains in the mountains. Агафья Карповна tried to do it herself with the help of the monk Guri, but in the end, they failed. The autumn flood, which suddenly intensified due to continuous precipitation, broke the dam and carried it down the river. It also washed away the work of many years. Not only that, the Тайга Дедлог was left without fish for the winter, so now it's still necessary to make all the details of the new fish weir. And the fragile woman cannot recover it herself. But if she still tries it, when will she pray? And the prayer is the main thing for the recluse, because it connects a person with God like an umbilical cord that gives life to a child in the womb of the mother. And the rupture of this umbilical cord, St. Paisios of Mount Athos said, is fraught with spiritual death for man. So Агафья Карповна turned to be in such desperate situation when once volunteers of Миря arrived to her aid again. Now she is choosing a new place to install the dam, as the old one is no longer suitable because of the change of the riverbed. Watching her prepare for a new conquest of the Yerinat River, we remember the words of Ерофей Седов, Песков's partner on the first trips to Ликов's family. In Nature, he told us at the first meeting in 2011, there are no deadlocks, neither in the lives of the righteous people as we see. A new place for the fishing dam on the river was found, and our friendly team started its activity around it. Ерофей Седов's son, Николас, experienced Тайга Man and Агафья's godson, sets the tone for it. We met him during our first visit to the Тайга Дедлог in 2011, and since then we have been maintaining friendship and close partnership. And our team in this expedition looks impressively. Firstly, it includes 16 people, and secondly, combines the experience of veterans of volunteer trips and great enthusiasm of beginners. Experience, of course, is primarily from Nicholas and his countrymate, Sergei Krikinov, a miner from Tashtagol. Sergei is for the second time here with us at Агафья Карповна place. And the veterans are Nikolai Shcherbakov, Maxim Safonov, Ilya Bartsev, Daniil Gorbatyuk. For a few previous visits to the Yerenat River, they not only learned how to develop any taiga work, but also gained valuable experience in organizing camp life. The beginners are Dmitry Zaitsev, Dmitry Petrov, Sofia Bushneva, and Ekaterina Nikitenkova. They only need to take an example from experienced hikers and keep up with anything. Carried away by the spring flood, the former fish weir served for many years and was not constructed just in one day. But what the flood did in the harsh taiga reality is comparable to a technogenic disaster in the city. And Nicholas and Sergei will have to eliminate the consequences of the disaster in a short time. Fortunately, they have a chainsaw, the first assistant in the taiga. And the homemade handsaw, which Agafya Karpovna has, won't help here. Now they are constructing tripods that will stand across the river and take on long and thick poles. These poles, in turn, will close tripods in a single structure and will be a support for the bars, which will delay the fish sliding into the lower reaches of the river. Selected for a new fish weir part of the river is wider than the previous one and has flat and smooth banks. Despite a greater number of tripods and slake will be needed to overlap the river, there is a hope that the next flood will not destroy the fishing dam. The recluse kept in mind all this, choosing a new location for the fish weir. Installation of tripods on a stony bed of the river is not an easy task, and here it is necessary to bear in mind that new tripods are made of a fresh tree and therefore much heavier than the ones that were lost. It's difficult even to imagine how the recluse would have coped with them alone. At this stage, two important conditions are needed to be observed. To place the tripod in a line that poles lay flat on them, and to achieve full stability of the pillars. Any deviations can subsequently turn into trouble. But everything goes as it should, because Agafya Karpovna is always with the guys. And all the time she tries to help where they will cope with it without her help, she's so used to it, doing everything herself. And with long, thick poles, the story is the same as with the tripods. They are simply very heavy. They can only be dragged along the rocky shore the way the Volga boatmen did. And in the water, which reduces the weight of the logs, they are not easy to manage. But still young force and desire to make good to the person who does good to people by prayers win. On this occasion, Saint Paisios of Mount Athos said that the monk is doing a prayer in silence and said tons of aid to his fellow men. Агафья Карповна is not a nun, but lives in the monastery of the three-handed Theotokos according to the monastic charter, and her prayers are about everyone outside the taiga deadlock in need of help, about Russia and about the whole world, and as the Queen of Baitguri noted, she belongs to the category of people whom the Lord hears. She would now have to pray and not to waste precious time on construction, but here comes the law of the wild nature that cannot be ignored if she wishes to continue the prayer walk. Connected to each other, tripods are slowly starting to look like the future fishing dam. We will need to lay a few rows of thick poles for its stability, tie them with wire, fasten to the tripod so that the fish weir could resist the pressure of water, because its level will inevitably rise when the river flow meets an obstacle. The next step in the construction of the fish weir, installation on the ready flooring of special wooden bars, which the recluse calls fishing bands. But first, these fishing bands should be built, because the old stock was carried away by the flood. Simple poles are used in their construction, and also the stick chopped of deciduous boards. These boards are not brought to the taiga deadlock by someone. Agafya Karpovna produces them herself, using axe and birch wedges. Now, she is similarly disbanding the workpiece for the fishing bands, so that you can visualize, as in the taiga, where there are no sawmills and electricity, the necessary household building material is produced. This method was used by the recluse 30 years ago, when she was preparing resettlement from the north, that is from the former place of habitat, where the Likovs family was discovered by the geologist. And then she picked up chopped wood heavy blocks, lifted them to 3 meter high and installed them on the close standing trees. She got kind of a granary, where she hided products and seed potatoes from bears and chipmunks. Such features of self-sufficiency of the taiga deadlock can be seen at every step. The whole life here is based on proven for centuries methods of survival, the main thing in which reliance on your own strengths and God's help. For example, there is a hole among the garden tackles which Agafya Karpovna made herself from the available material. And it's even needless to say about birch bark containers, baskets and other items made of bark. At the time of complete seclusion, all the glassware in her everyday life was made of birch bark. That's for now. Thanks to the help of the guests, she had a lot of pots and buckets at her place.
Агафья Карповна во всем полагается на волю Божию. В субботу мы делали заездок, но пошел сильный дождь, не успели сделать. Часть плотины сделана, а часть нет. Агафья Карповна переживает, как бы не смыла плотину, дожди идут. Я рядом стою, тоже переживаю. Она это видит и тут же переключается. Дождь заканчивается, и красивая радуга. Она тут же в заботах умеет видеть, ценить и показать красоту природы. Говорит, смотри, как красиво, действительно радуга, а рядом еще вторая радуга. И вот полагаясь на волю Божию, суббота, воскресенье, вот сегодня понедельник, плотина целая, мы ее достраиваем. Сегодня надо успеть достроить, потому что завтра тоже праздник, Успение Пресвятой Богородицы, а в праздник не работают. Вот так, на все воля Божия.
What did the guys expect at staying for hours in the cold water of a mountain river? We can only guess. But it wouldn't be possible without the will of God, for sure. During the test of rain, some people were on the shore and the others in the river. It was nowhere to hide, and even more, not everyone had raincoats. But everyone worked. Fortunately, the rain ended quickly, and two rainbows appeared immediately, what made Agafya Karpovna so happy. She told us that the moisture rises in the rainbow to the heavens to again be spilled on earth with a vivifying force. After a cold rain shower, no one got sick. At the end of the expedition, all remembered how cool it was to get in the full sense in the middle of the water element and get out of it without any loss. Next to the fish fair on the banks of the river, the reckless will have temporary housing, a booth, or boothy, as she calls it. This simple structure consists of a frame covered with polyethylene for protection from rain and wind, a stove made of large boulders and several wooden hangers on which the cold grayling will dry is situated in this booth. The construction is pretty simple here, but you need to know from the personal experience how to erect it. And the Moscow Brotherhood is not so rich in that. But they have a skilled taiga man and a regular participant of our volunteer team Sergey nearby. Агафья Карповна will sleep here as well, laying on the sandy floor, some rug. And she will pray all the long hours of stay in the fishing boothy. It's time to milk the goat. Katya Poznikova hasn't had the chance to do this yet, and then the luck has fallen, to master a new occupation and even more, under the tutelage of such an instructor as the world-famous recluse. And it's not in vain that Saint Paisio said in his conversations with pilgrims, the right spiritual path is to forget the good you've done and to remember the good done to you by others. Who found such state, he noted, becomes, and here the saint fell silent and after a pause pronounced, a man, and he added, God's man. According to his thought, to become a man of God, you just have to be a normal person. Агафья Карповна can't wait to give the milk, which she received and which could be useful for cooking a reserve of cottage cheese to the winter, to the volunteers. And she does it, apparently with great pleasure. Looking at the recluse at this moment, you get convinced that she's for us a living illustration of the words of Paisios of Mount Athos, as well as the spiritual tuning fork about which Metropolitan Cornelius spoke at the beginning of the film. There is a lot of work in the taiga squatting at the end of summer, and it's not allowed to do this work on any day, as the participant of volunteer team Nina noticed earlier. Sunday is a small Easter, and during our stay in the taiga deadlock, there were two other Orthodox holidays. Therefore, in the working days, we can't waste 1 hour and even 1 minute. The sorting out of old potatoes solves two problems. The volunteers release the cellar for laying a new harvest and ensure the rational use of the remnants of the previous one. One part of the potatoes they will use as meal for them, another part is left for George, and the rest which will be left will be used at the goats and chickens feeding. And it's everywhere like this. None of the old stock on the squatting is not lost. Everything, up to the last potato, finds its use. As in real life, the principle of self-sufficiency of the taiga deadlock. And the potatoes here are excellent, you won't believe, but according to the recluse, she has the seeds which have been reproduced continuously for 100 years. However, there is a variety of potatoes in the farm. Although the tubers that were stored in the cellar for almost a year gave long sprouts but retained high commercial properties, which usually doesn't happen. Apparently, the recluse has very particular cellar, or the whole atmosphere of the taiga deadlock, as noted by the volunteer Ilya, helps to break the existing limits. You can once again make sure of such specific phenomenon of the holy abode on the Yerinat River in the transportation of the wood from the lowlands to the huts. Working conditions are extremely tough here. The rise of the step hill, the soil soaked from the continuous rain, and the awkward bunch of raw logs on the back. And lots of wood need to be transported. It is another sacrifice exam for the volunteers of Miria. These video frames show how hard it is for guys. Why, let's ask ourselves, do they need it? And here for what? Time is changeable. It happens both. Peace-safe and difficult military times, catastrophic and filled with troubles which can be overcome only by the mutual work helping to all. And every century in the history of our country was filled with testing people's ability to survive in deadly situations. In the harsh war years of any war, we know many cases when only the full and the hardest effort helped our soldiers to survive and to break any force and any situation. Is there anything in common between the events of the war years and the routine business that the guys are busy with on the hillside in the taiga deadlock? There is. The common thing between them is the sacrifice, which is the essence of the ascetic mission of the recluse Агафья Лыкова. Both in the transportation of the wood on a slippery and steep slope and in their actions on a fish weir, there is a courage and dedication which are the driving force in all the people. As if Saint Paisio said about our guys, if someone learns in advance to think not about himself but about others, then when in danger he will also think about others. Let's think about that. Who knows what awaits us at the next turn of history? Living in such difficult years as now, we need to be, on the advice of the saint, not just ready, but three times ready.
Так вот, Гури говорит, тяжело ей по лестницам ходить, говорит, 70 ступенькам. Там она, говорит, идет, не жалуется, а тут как по лестнице ей.
Взято.
Ну, мужики сейчас все сюда занесут.
Да, вот задача сюда поднять.
А то на левой ноге вот подымается. Я все направо и ходила, а лево-то так же упираться-то никак. Да и вот сюда заденешь.
И больно.
Невыносимо было. А то она опять направо это ходила. Теперь права-то нога совсем.
Агафка, 72 вам года, да?
3 исполнится, все в Пасху.
Winter in the taiga deadlock greatly complicates any test of the summer season. We decided to specially show what, in attempt to bring wood herself from the very lowland, where at the end of the last summer the guys had to work hard to perform their task, would have turned out for Агафья Карповна. It is unlikely, of course, that the recluse would need to climb into a snow trap because there is wood on the other side of the river, harvested by the expedition of Miria 2 years ago. But as it turned out from the conversation with Агафья Карповна, it was not as easy as it seemed to be with them.
Из-за реки сухих тодоров я не смогла принести, а морозы-то сильные после богоявления носились.
Да, были, ага. И у нас тоже.
И суть посуда вот эта складывала, все суть не поразмерзалась.
В избушке?
В избе у меня. Угу. Дрова-то сыры лето сны-то. Они все затопят, тепла не дают. Потом усну, потухнет совсем песика-то. И я стою. Да буду огня-то, песику затоплю, а сама скорее под одеяло только и косок под одеяло. От их греться. Вот так вот пришлось неделю пережить.
Да, а конечно, если бы у Гурья были в силы, бы, конечно, он помог.
Мороз сильный, пока с козами управились, солнце закатится, сапоги застынут колом, а за реку идти туда. Ну, мороз далеко все-таки, а все, ну и принесет связаночку. А кого я? И вот насевали это сырья и хлебников, потаскал дров-то.
Как раз в эту поездку мы занимались тем, что перевозили дрова с того берега, потому что летом они были недоступны. И эта работа должна быть сделана здесь, потому что на этом берегу очень трудно доставать дрова, потому что в округе есть уже нет сухостоя, а на том берегу он есть. И мы как раз восполнили вот этот пробел в этой поездке и привезли значительное количество дров. Я думаю, видно на заднем фоне, это только небольшая часть из них.
In winter, there is a serene silence in the taiga deadlock that the Yerinat River will wake when freed from the ice shell. This year, with the arrival of the volunteers of Myriad, Taiga Squatting had to part with the patriarchal winter slammer. Such motorcycle town vehicle wouldn't surprise anyone somewhere in the suburbs, but here, far from the machine civilization, neither the recluse nor the surrounding mountains haven't seen or heard about anything like this. And as a result, we were able to quickly make her life easier. Very few people can perform such feat of life in the taiga deadlock as Agafya Karpovna does, but she doesn't consider her own life to be any outstanding in comparison with the fate of other people. She just lives, and that's it, living a Christian life. So, by the way, a father of the Likovs family, Karp Iosifovich, formulated the credo of the family when answering the question of Vasily Piskov whether he regrets that he lived in the deep taiga in suffering and doing so much work for 3 decades. And what to regret? We lived as Christians. Without hesitating, he answered. However, to live in a Christian way in the conditions of persecution of Christians, it was necessary not to conform, according to the Old Apostolic Testament in that century, and to live the human world. Here it is, lived as Christians, still continues in the present day at the taiga deadlock. To see the feat of Christian life firsthand, to touch it, to take something from it as a warning to themselves, is a great success for those who have been to the recluse. And the volunteers from Myriad are among them. They come here to work and help the recluse, and it turns out they get exactly the spiritual masterclass about which Metropolitan Cornelius said at the beginning of the film. Living away from people when the country is different and there is no persecution of believers, it is now a cross for Agafya Karpovna. And as the Holy Fathers say, you cannot refuse the cross, but God gives strength to carry it. And the example of the recluse shows us that she is a person who has a sacrifice, doesn't whine, and is not burdened by it, but only rejoice. What you see now, outside the taiga deadlock, no one has ever seen. No one before us has been able to shot a video as a recluse, being away from the Orthodox churches all her life, meets a priest. This is Father Igor from Novokuznetsk Community of Old Believers. He arrived instead of Agafya's spiritual father Vladimir from Orenburg, who couldn't leave the church because of the feast of the Dormition of the Mother of God, and visits the taiga deadlock to meet the spiritual daughter. Father Vladimir came to the Yerinat River in the early November 2011 for the first time. His trip was a response to Agafya's letter of appeal to the Metropolitan of Moscow and All Rus, Cornelius. She wrote that her ancestors always lived and prayed with priests who were subsequently tortured. Father Vladimir became the first full-fledged Old Believer churchman after the split who came into contact with the Likovs family, even though in the person of only one, Agafya. Not from fleeting, as it was in the post-Soviet years, but canonical. For Agafья, who joined the Russian Orthodox Old Believer Church from that moment on, the circle of history and the great standing for the faith started by her ancestors was closed. And the event itself, a reunion with the Mother Church, is a landmark, after all. Before, Agafья existed as a fragment of the past in the depths of centuries of patristic Atlantis. Father Vladimir spent 2 days at the Yerenat River. With the blessings of Metropolitan Cornelius, he took Agafья to confession, held the rank of completion of her baptism, after which she was brought to the sacrament of communion. He visited the recluse then for several times. And now again she had the opportunity to pass the main Christian sacraments, confession and Holy Communion, the infrequent when owed opportunity in her situation. The priest prepares for the sacraments of confession and communion of the recluse, as well as for the following consecration of her home. He prays in the hut where there are ancient icons that accompany different generations of Lykov's family in their movement in the north of central Russia, the Ural region and Siberia. The holy prismatic gospel is also here. After the prayer, he confesses Agafья. The confession we didn't film, of course, but you can see everything else.
Все, Агафьюшка, Бог любит тебя.
Я думала, уголь в цвет зимы. От берёз-то гора.
Ага. С остроком Божьим и верой приступите и крестись. Благословен гряды его, и мы Господне, Бог Господь, явися нам. Вот так, держи, держи, чтоб нам ничего не пролить. Честное и пречное тело и кровь Господа Бога и Спаса нашего Иисуса Христа. Подается рабе Божией Агафьи. В день принесения честного огня, подарен образа Господней, и всех ради святых, несут не в осуждение. Тело Христово прими, да бессмертного вкусите, на восстановление грехов и в жизнь вечную. Сейчас все убивай, все принимай. Господа, чашу целую. Аллилуйя! Ныне отпущаешь раба Твоего, Владыка, по глаголу Туму с миром, яковитесть и отчима и спасение Твои будут. Еще готово пред лицем всех людей, свет в откровении, языком и славы люди Твоих, Израиля. Давай с тобой, милу нас, святые Божьи, святые, крепкие, святые, помилуй нас. Слава Отцу и Сыну, Святому Духу, ныне присливаю Тебе, веком, аминь. Царствие Твое, да будет воля Твоя. Яко на небеси и на земле, хлеб наш насущный, дай нам днесь, остави нам долги наши, и кажи мы наставляем должникам нашим. И не веди нас во искушение, но избави нас от лукавого, как Твое царство и силы, и слава Отца и Сына, Святого Духа, ныне присылай и веков. Спаси, Господи, и Своей благослови достояние. Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй. Честнейшую херувима, славнейшего истину Серафим, без остроения Бога славорощую, сущую Богородицу Тебя величаем. Слава Тебе, Боже наш, упование наше, слава Тебе, слава Отцу и Сыну и Святому Духу, и ныне пресны во веки веков, аминь. Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, благослови. Христос, истинный Бог наш, молитвен Пречистого Матери, силу честного творящего креста, всех ради святых, помилуй, спаси от нас, яко благо человека. Спаси, Господи, люди своя, и благослови достояние свое. Победы православным христианам нас упротивная даруй, и своя сохраняя крестом люди. Спаси, Господи, люди своя, и благослови достояние свое. Победы православным христианам нас упротивная даруй, и своя сохраняя крестом люди. Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй. Слава Тебе, Боже, наше упование, наше слава Тебе, слава Отцу и Сыну, Святому Духу, и ныне пресно, и во веки веков. Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, благослови.
Христос истинный Бог наш, молитвы пречистой, и Матери всех, всемочных растворящих креста, святых и святых, помилуй, спаси от нас, яко благо человека и нас. Аминь, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Господи, помилуй, Боже, милости будем грешному, создав мне, Господи, и помилуй меня, Вячесла, согреши, Господи, помилуй, прости меня грешного. Господи Иисусе Христе, Сыне Божий, помилуй нас. Поздравляю тебя с принятием Христовых тайн, со священием храмины твои, во славу Божию.
Слава Богу. Unfortunately, the stay of the priest at Agafia's Lygava place could not be long. When parting, they still stood on the high bank of the river, and Father Igor sang something to the recluse. Our volunteer expedition has come to an end too, but we don't want to rush the separation with Agafia Karpovna. The tie-guarded lock hardly let us go.
Агафья Карповна – это целая книга. Ее можно изучать, можно много говорить. Вот вчера мне посчастливилось целый день провести возле Агафьи Карповны, потому что был праздник Успения Пресвятой Богородицы, работать нельзя, и мы пошли на озеро. А на обратном пути собирали ягоды и слушали рассказ, длинный, подробный рассказ Агафьи Карповны, как вот уже 40 лет назад геологи нашли их старообрядческую семью Лыковых в тайге. За эти 40 лет сюда приходили разные люди с разными целями, с разными судьбами. Кто-то на пару дней, кто-то на несколько лет. Но удивительно, что Агафья Карповна чувствует и умеет понимать человеческую сущность. Она обо всех рассказывала с добром и любовью. Я у нее переспросила, а люди хорошие приходили сюда? Она сказала, да. Я уточнила, все? Да, ответила она. И вот удивительно, что в этой суровой природе она сумела сохранить любовь ко всему окружающему. Наверное, это потому, что живет она по законам и заповедям Божьим. А главное, она сумела сохранить чистоту веры своих предков, ради которой они ушли из мира. Любые невзгоды, лишения не нарушают ее душевного покоя, потому что она во всем полагается на волю Божию. А нам предстоит сегодня улетать. И предстоит задуматься, а те ли цели мы преследуем? И настолько ли важна наше стремление в том цивилизованном мире –